presentations. We have wonderful rabbinic and married couple participants on the Zoom. And we hope to have a good period of time at the end for interactions and questions from participants. So let me immediately turn the virtual microphone over to Rabbi Rachel Ain, who is the rabbi of Sutton Place Synagogue here in New York. Rachel.
It is so great to see so many of you, some faces that I haven't seen in a while, and some of my own members of the community, as well as to be with my colleagues from across the world, and to be together and to think about this important message of weddings, celebrations, and of course, the shared commitment to the Masorti movement and the values and strengthened relationship between those of us here in North America and those in Israel, and knowing how do we take our values, our sense of authenticity, and bring them to a fore, even in complicated days such as COVID-19, where the struggles that we have don't stop just because there is a pandemic. They're just highlighted in different ways. So let me tell you what we're gonna do this afternoon, well, and for this evening or this morning, depending where you're watching from. I want to speak for a few minutes about what are some of the main ideas that are fueling this conversation. Then I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Rabbi Ari Hasit, who will speak about the current reality, both in terms of the law in Israel regarding Masorti weddings and what he's seeing on the ground. We'll have an opportunity to hear from a wonderful couple who chose to get married in a Masorti ceremony, knowing some of the challenges that come with that, but choosing to anyway. And then I'll hear from my colleague, Rabbi Natalia Singer, to talk about what are the challenges and successes with the Masorti movement and weddings and some of the impact we're seeing. And so how this as a micro issue can be seen in a macro way. From there, we'll have an opportunity to open up for questions. So if you have questions, we invite you to write them in the chat bar. We're not gonna have people ask the questions because that gets complicated on these kind of calls. So please type your question in and then I'll close. So I want to start actually by reflecting on something which doesn't feel like the Masorti movement at all. And that is the hit Netflix show Unorthodox. Raise your hand if you saw Unorthodox. Okay, see a bunch of people saw it. That show gave us a glimpse into something that felt both familiar and foreign at the same time. And for me, one of the most painful scenes was actually the wedding scene. I'm not giving anything away. She gets married. There is a wedding scene. And it is a wedding that was not like my wedding at all. Yes, I wore a veil, but the veil that the bride wore in Unorthodox was more like a lampshade. The silence of the voice, of lack of voice of the bride, Esti, and Unorthodox was completely different than the voice given to both brides and grooms in an egalitarian setting. And so trying to understand what is both authentic and traditional, knowing that the words spoken under that chuppah in Unorthodox were in fact mainly the same, not completely, but mainly the same words that we say, is something to hold on to. So what we want to explore today is what is authentic traditional Judaism in an egalitarian, modern, pluralistic context that we can celebrate? And how do we elevate these moments, knowing that it's not always so easy, even in our Jewish home? So with that, I want to turn it over to Ari to tell us what's the reality.
Sure. Thank you very much, Rabbi Ain. It's very nice to see all of the familiar faces here. Two of them are particularly familiar since they're my parents, but also a number of other familiar names and faces. Wonderful to see all of you. Thank you for joining us tonight. Rabbi Ain said that the wedding scene in Unorthodox was not at all like her wedding. I cannot describe anything as being like my wedding because I have, to the same wonderful woman, had three weddings. And that explains a little bit about what is the absurdity of what's going on in Israel today. When my wife and I got engaged not too long ago, just under 6 years ago, we had long discussions. She comes from an Orthodox background and is very deeply committed to egalitarianism, but is also self-defined as Orthodox. I grew up in a conservative home in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, and of course, am a Masorti rabbi. At that time, I was a Masorti rabbinical student. we wanted to find something that really worked for both of us. And so we decided to ask two important figures in our lives to co-officiate the wedding. The first was my wife is my wife's father, who is very much Orthodox. He's a Talmud professor at the Hebrew University, and he has an open mind. And the second is my rabbi, my teacher, my mentor, Rabbi Chaya Rowan Becker, a wonderful young rabbi who was ordained about 15 years ago at Schechter. And what is different than for a lot of people in Israel, she's also a woman, which means that they're, you know, even though I think that that's a wonderful thing, lots of Israelis aren't sure that a woman can officiate a wedding. And I think, unfortunately, that my rabbinic colleagues here, Rabbi Ein and Rabbi Natali, Rabbi Leshize, will talk about the challenges of that as women. But we had a really a tour de force of two wonderful people to officiate our wedding, people with experience, people who understand the laws of all the Jewish weddings. We were witnessed by 350 of our closest friends and family in a beautiful chuppah. And we knew that in order to be recognized and registered as married in the state of Israel, we needed to have a civil ceremony in the United States. So 2 weeks before our own wedding, we found ourselves in the United States for the wedding of dear friends and my sister-in-law and brother-in-law squared, my sister's brother-in-law and sister-in-law. And while we were in the States for their wedding, we decided to go to City Hall in New York to get a marriage license, asked a friend with a license to be a universal life minister to officiate a beautiful 15-minute ceremony for us at a kosher restaurant in New York City, witnessed by 20 friends and a handful of family. And we expected to bring that to the Interior Ministry in Israel and say, please register us as married, even though the Talmudic expert on ketubot and on Jewish wedding laws was our officiant, a man who is considered to be really quite the expert, even by ultra-Orthodox. We knew that this secular wedding in New York was going to count. As it turned out, as bad as bureaucracy is in Israel, in New York City, the bureaucracy is also bad. The city of New York lost the forms for our wedding. And when we returned to the United States 2.5 months later, 2 months after our own wedding for my sister's wedding, we found our way back in City Hall with one witness and got married with the Justice of the Peace. And so while our chuppah was held on January 5th of 2015, the state of Israel believes that we've been married since March 5th, when we had the total civil marriage with one happened to be Jewish witness and one non-Jewish Justice of the Peace. And that's how we're married today. And this is a story that I find myself explaining time and time again to different couples who come to me and ask for me to officiate their wedding. And I would say that I get three types of couples who come to me. I get, first and foremost, I get couples who want me to officiate their wedding. People who have heard about me, who know me, who are present at a wedding that I've officiated and say, Rabbi Ari Hasid is the person that we want to officiate for our wedding. And 90% of the time, I get to say yes to those people and we move forward. The other 10% of the time, they might be friends of mine who served with me in the military or in other places in my Israel life, and they don't even know that I'm not a Rabbanut rabbi. I'm not a member of Israel's rabbinic establishment. They just know that I'm a rabbi. And they say, wow, we have a friend who's a rabbi. How special would that be? And they ask me to officiate, and I explain to them that everything will be very traditional, that I'll spend time with them, that we'll go over it, that they'll know the ceremony, that they'll really be present. They're not going to be extras in a script that the rabbi brings, but rather they're going to be the stars of the show. And then everything sounds wonderful, but then I tell them that they won't be recognized as married by the state of Israel. And they look at me sadly and they say, thank you, Ari. Israel's very informal. Everyone calls me Ari. They say, thank you, Ari. But it's really important for us to be legally married in Israel. It's important to us ideologically. It's important to us practically. Thank you so much. If you can recommend an Orthodox rabbi for us, we would really love that. The only time I was able to do that with a full heart was the one time that somebody I met sort of by chance, both of us driving to from Jerusalem to Tel Aviv. We had a ride together. And he asked me if I knew the most egalitarian rabbi that he could find with an Orthodox wedding. And it happened to be that my dear friend who set up my wife and me is a female Orthodox rabbi. And she officiated that wedding and was able to register them with the state. Unfortunately, since then, the rabbi who ordained her and backed her up was caught, and she can no longer officiate those weddings legally. So what we have in Israel is an old law that goes back to the Turkish times, so we're talking about going back 500 years, which says that every member of a given religion turns to their own religious body to be recognized and to be married, and the Orthodox rabbinate, be it Ashkenazi or Sephardi, are the people who are in charge. So anyone who wants to get married has to have an Orthodox wedding, an Orthodox officiant, and it has to be either Ashkenazi or Sephardi, which of course leaves behind not only people who are ideologically tied to the conservative movement, but of course also Ethiopians aren't able to have their own spiritual leaders lead their weddings. People who were born Jewish abroad, who were able to make aliyah as Jews, but whose mother had a conversion through a conservative Beit Din before they were born, those people cannot get legally married in the state of Israel. Of course, same-sex couples. Many of our conservative colleagues will be happy to officiate those weddings. Some do not. We're a pluralistic movement. Same-sex couples cannot get legally married in Israel. If they'd like to get married, they can go to Denmark, pay a large fee, and come back with their Danish wedding certificate and register in the Interior Ministry. Of course, they can also do that in the United States or Canada. Other couples, if they want to be, can go to Cyprus, or that could. Once upon a time, 2 months ago, they could go to Cyprus or to other countries to get legally married there and to bring it back, no matter how traditional their chuppah, their Jewish wedding, is here in Israel. There is, of course, another option that some couples decide to do, which is Israel actually has very small c conservative laws regarding marriage and very liberal laws regarding common law marriage. And so many Israelis choose to just forego registering as married altogether in Israel. They have the officiant, be it a rabbi or somebody who is dear to them. Sadly, in my opinion, some people are so turned off by the rabbinut, by the rabbinate, that they choose to have a totally non-traditional wedding. They do that, and then they go to all the different institutions in Israel, and they say, well, we live as if we are married, and those institutions recognize them. The usual benefit of that is that any couple that gets divorced in Israel has to go through their religious body to get divorced if they're recognized as married. And that is, of course, for Jews, the chief rabbinate. And the chief rabbinate is not a place that a lot of people want to go into for their divorce. If both members of the couple agree that their divorce should take place somewhere else, they can come to us if it's a conservative marriage and have a conservative Beit Din officiate the divorce. If they did not have a Jewish wedding to begin with, they can just go to the courts and figure out how to solve their issues in that way or divide it up in other ways. And in that regard, people think it's actually advantageous not to get registered as married in Israel. And almost every right that somebody has, they can get through being common law married. The only two which are in fact big deals, and we'll see if this changes over time, but as of I last knew, you can only adopt if both members of the couple are married to each other. Otherwise, only one parent can adopt and the other one cannot. So if you'd like to adopt children and have both recognized as parents, you need to be married. What I sometimes say to couples is that if they want to not be married and they decide to adopt later on, they can then choose at that point when it becomes relevant to go get legally married. And the other issue is one of where another country needs to recognize the marriage in order for both of them to get a visa to work in that country. So if, for example, one of them gets a job as a shaliach, as an emissary through the Jewish agency in the United States will not automatically grant a visa to their partner if they're not recognized as married. Somewhat interestingly, and I say this jokingly, the Interior Ministry does not recognize same-sex marriages, but the Foreign Ministry recognizes same-sex marriages. And our colleague, Rabbi Mikey Goldstein, his husband is an ambassador of Israel. And Rabbi Goldstein is able to have a diplomatic passport because even though the country doesn't recognize them as married, the foreign ministry does. And so he can go and serve along with his husband when he needs to. So there are a lot, those are different, the legal pieces of it. I talked about the couples who come to me. I actually would say I get probably 60% of the couples come to me because they want to get married in what I call a bandit outlaw marriage. Our weddings are not only not recognized, they are technically illegal. There is a threat of 2 years in prison for getting married in a traditional Jewish wedding with a rabbi that you've spent time getting to know, who is not a member of the rabbinate. The current legal advisor to the state has informed the police to please not enforce this law. I have a feeling that if this law is enforced even once and one of us gets arrested, our colleague was detained but was not arrested. If this happens even once, we'll take it to the Supreme Court, and within a matter of months, the entire monopoly of the chief rabbinate will disappear. So I think it is in everybody's interest, so to speak, to not arrest us other than us. My wife always tells me that if I get arrested and don't come home, especially from a Friday wedding before Shabbat, that I'll have to find a new wife. But other than that, I think it would actually be our dream to get arrested in one of these weddings and to really take down this system, which I think is totally corrupt. But in the meantime, we're lucky that lots of Israelis come to us because what they want is a meaningful experience. They want to feel like it is their wedding, it is not somebody else's wedding. And having a Masorti rabbi who treats every single member of a couple as being really at the center, I think makes people feel like this really matters to them. It's not just somebody who checks off a couple of boxes, has to look off a name card to see what the name of the bride is the day of the wedding, takes their envelope with their illegal payment and leave, but rather somebody who actually really invests.
All right, thank you. We're going to turn it over to Michal and Mickey now, who are going to share their story. They're not in the conservative rabbinate, Masorti rabbinate, but they're a product of the Masorti movement, and they're going to talk about why they made the decision to get married as they did. So they just need to unmute themselves.
Hi.
Hi, everybody.
My name is Michal.
Mickey.
This is Mickey. Actually, I'll tell a bit about my background. I grew up in Rehovot, in a conservative synagogue, Adat Shalom Emanuel. My family has been a member of the synagogue for my entire life, and I grew up in Noam in the youth movement. I went to the army through the youth movement through the educational corps, and I, after the army, did some shlichut in Australia, also through the movement. I came back, started studying medicine, and met this man over here.
So, as you said, both of us are a product of the Masorti movement, I guess. So my parents are both from New York. They moved here. We are also part of a conservative movement in Jerusalem, where I was born. And I also grew up in the youth movement of the Masorti movement. And pretty much I didn't go to the army through the movement or and all that, but pretty much it's been a big part of my life ever since I can remember. So it was pretty natural for us to get married through the Masorti movement, even with all the difficulties that come with that kind of, that sort of a decision.
Yeah, I think one of our very big advantages was that we both came from similar backgrounds, and we both thought for us it's important to portray our Masorti background in our wedding and to have a rabbi to officiate who, like Ari said, is someone that we know. The rabbi who officiated our wedding is a very good friend of Miki's parents. And we're also very lucky that our families were very supportive of this. We have not one story of many stories of friends who have struggled with their families and with criticism from their communities about having either conservative reform or even totally secular weddings, because I think in the more open modern society we came from, people aren't so sure that this is the first option they want to turn to when they decide that they are going to get married, which I think is a change to what was the situation maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And we have friends whose parents disagree or whose in-laws disagree, and it's a struggle for them. So for me, I think we were really lucky to have that support from our family and to know that this is for us our decision from the beginning, and our families were with us 100%. And our wedding was, I think, very special for us. Everyone thinks their wedding is special, but I think what was special about our wedding, which is, I think, different to other people, that maybe not everyone, but some of our friends who I think are maybe take this, the like you see the ketubah signing and the chuppah is something you have to just skim through at the wedding so that you can continue to the other more important dancing parts. And for us, this was a very, very big part of our wedding ceremony. And I think that's one of the things that also is maybe a bit disappointing or sad about young, more secular people today, is that for them, it's a technicality. And for us, it was a part of our Jewish identity to make sure that our wedding is a Jewish wedding and that has a major Jewish and pluralistic part and component in it. I think one of the funniest things, Tammy was showing the pictures, that Miki's sister got married also here in Israel with a conservative rabbi, and her wedding was not recognized by the state of Israel. That's on the right. And you can see on her on the left that after they got married, they went to the United States and they got married, and Elvis officiated their wedding. And with that wedding, they could come back and register in the state of Israel. So I think that shows a bit the absurdity of the issue.
I just would like to add that. So Michal was talking about the fact that some people have problems not only making the decision for themselves, but also with their families, because getting a wedding is not only part of your life, it's part of your whole family's life. And I think that sometimes people from, I don't want to say my parents and their friends and that generation who grew up in Israel mostly, it's harder for them to see us doing something different. The rabbinate has always been the authority in Israel, and not getting married through the rabbinate is against the law, like Ari said. And sometimes that as itself is very sort of disappointing, or people don't agree on it, because why would you do something against the law that's just going to make you, just going to give you some trouble for the rest of your life, and not just, you know, do a quickie, get some rabbi, and finish it off. So that's one of the reasons also people are a little bit afraid to go and do, I don't know, secular or Masorti weddings here in Israel. And another thing that I wanted to add regarding the wedding, the whole wedding ceremony, is that it has nothing to do with the actual ceremony or who's doing the ceremony. It is a technicality of if the rabbi is listed in the rabbinate. So not only have some of our friends, or a lot of our friends, told us that our wedding was the most religious wedding they've ever been at in their life, because we really, it was very important to us to do a lot of things traditionally. Also, so that it's a big deal. And I think that also it creates a big problem, because it means that it's, when you feel, even when I go abroad and get married and come back, eventually you're getting listed in the rabbinate, sort of. Of course, the state recognizes it, but it sort of goes in their listings. And to me, it, even that feels sort of like I'm supporting the system that allows you to do that. So I was sort of also against going abroad and getting married, just because I feel like then I'm sort of working around the system to get back to where everybody is, but that's not where I think that we need to be. I think that if I chose to do something that is different, then as Ari said, there's an option in Israel of listing as common in law marriage, which is also actually they have that in a few states in the in America, as I recall. And we don't get all exact same legal rights as people who are married, but pretty much almost everything. So that's sort of the status that we are at. Well, we haven't gotten married officially anywhere, really. Except for, you know, here with all the people who believe us. And
and people sometimes ask me, so you're not married? And I tell them, I'm halachically married. I am living in a loving relationship, and we have a wonderful daughter. And I think that that's part of the thing. I think that the state is telling me I'm not married, but reality is different. And I think reality for many Israelis is different. And for my friends, for most people who see me, they know I'm married. It doesn't really, like Ari said, it's illegal, but no one is doing anything about it. So I think people are continuing to do it. The numbers are growing. And I think maybe even without anyone getting arrested, we might be able to bring down the establishment just by saying we are not taking part in this and we are not going to be part of this establishment. So hopefully that's great. Where we're going. That's where we're heading.
Well, from your mouth to God's ears. So let's now hear how do we take this issue and think about it even broader, the challenges and successes of the Masorti movement? Natalie, you're muted. One second.
Sorry?
There. She's still muted.
Hold on.
Maybe you're not. Go ahead. Say.
Michal Natalie Lot.
I'm here.
There you go.
Okay. So hi everybody. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, as you want. Here is still Lag BaOmer. So in a few hours, we will end this Hilula of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. And this year, because of the Corona issues, no thousands of hundreds of people went to Meron, which is not so far from Kfar Vradim, to celebrate. What celebration? The celebration, according to what we know or what the Masoret told us that it's the birthday of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, but also his yahrzeit of most of the texts speak about the yahrzeit of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. And we have also a Midrash who told us that it's also his wedding anniversary. Three very important dates in one day. So it's a big celebration, but I want to talk about those three very important moments that we have, any of us, yes, any human, as life ritual, three significant life ritual during his life. Our birth, so we have the birthday, our death, Ad Me'a Ve'Esrim, until Me'a Ve'Esrim, and then we have in between the life most important event is love, is our, the act of love, what we call wedding or parity, but this is the third very significant moment, but the only one that we have some control on it, yes? Because we not decide to come, and we for sure are not, not everybody, but most of us will not decide just go. But to marry or not, that's something that we have the total control on it. That's something that I think this is the greatest gift that we have. I did not grow up in conservative movement, and my first marriage, I was twice, but my first marriage at age of 20, I was still very Orthodox, ultra-Orthodox even. I do remember the chief rabbi of Israel at this time, Rabbi Shapira, officiated the wedding, and many other rabbi along with him led, blessed, and did everything needed to get out of this ceremony as a married and sacred couple, Kedat Moshe v'Yisrael, as we said. They didn't ask my opinion in any moment of this ceremony. I was not part of this event in the deepest senses of the word. It was a men table, including, of course, the rabbis, my father, two witnesses, and my ex-husband, the father of my children, the groom. They closed the deal there. And in this main deal, I was passed by my father's authority to my husband's authority. Can overt mirshut ba'ala, mirshut avia, lirshut ba'ala. That's the deal. And I was only, kind of the paper that they sign on. And this memory of my chuppah, it was very exciting, but of course I did not say a word all over. I didn't even congratulate the Shechianu that today is so obvious to all the couple, even the Orthodox one, maybe more than Orthodox, who say Shechianu and bless this sacred moment. Even this, nothing, from the beginning until the end. This experience, I think, the most, maybe one of the most important trigger when I decide to divorce 7 years after with three children and decide slowly but surely to move to the conservative movement, it was one of the things that I said to myself, if I will have to remarry one day, I will never do it in this way. I want that this special moment, I want to be part of it. I want to understand what's going on. I want to be able to take responsibility also about this huge moment in my life. And it took me a few more years to fully become a conservative member and more to decide to become a rabbi. But from that moment, I took it upon myself to try and to do for grooms and brides around me what nobody do for me. I will have them voices. I will lead them to the tangle of these sacred texts. I teach and I will interpret them for them. What is essential in this chuppah moment, this love covenant. So they will be able to be part of it, not to look at, but to decide how to lead themselves in this way. So yes, the State of Israel does not recognize the existence of our ceremony. Indeed, this is a big challenge, but more and more, toda la'el, thanks to God, more and more young people like Michal, shachachti et Hashem,
Miki,
realize that they want to have the power for themselves. They want to take responsibility for Judaism, their tradition, their heritage, and it's an important part of what their family will be founded on. So as a woman and a rabbi, it's a little bit more complicated than Rabbi Hari said. I have no beard, thanks God. And my kippah, it's maybe, you know, a ribbon or some small and color things. A lot of people prefer men to officiate chuppot, to officiate also funerals that are just coming back from, and bar bat mitzvah, because male are more, I don't know how to say it, but maybe it's kind of authority, yes?
Authority. Authentic, yeah. That no, people authentic view.
Authority. But especially in Israel, I think it's a challenge also in the state, and my colleague like Rabbi Ain also have this kind of challenge. But in Israel, the only faces that people saw around when a chuppah take place is men. There's no civil marriage. So even, you know, you can have the authority of women officiate in a civil marriage. And here we have no civil marriage. So all over, it's only male. And I do remember one of my great chuppah that I did. So a couple, young couple, friend of the groom, come to me and say, oh, you're so wonderful. We're so excited. Wow. Do you know someone like you, but a man? And it was kind of, oh my God. But they were so sweet. I look at them and say, why? If it was so magnificent and great and sacred, why you want a man, a rabbi, a male rabbi? Yeah, but my grandfather, but the neighbor of my parents, but you know, it's complicated, etc., etc. So according to those manners around, we have no, I have maybe two or three weddings during a year. My colleague has much more. And I think that we have to add to the legal issues, also the gender issues.
Okay, so yeah. Thank you.
I have two minutes more?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so, but I want to look at the full cup because it's like Ba'omer and we want to celebrate love. And as Ari said, more and more Israeli want to do it in our way, Masorti movement, which our logo that we believe on is tradition and renewal together. So it will seem like the other chuppot, but with a twist. Not long ago, I got married to a wonderful couple of brides who were insistent that a female rabbi perform the wedding ceremony. And the truth it was, this request challenged me. And I found myself studying the issue very deeply so I could create for myself what seems so sacred and clear to me, namely the right to establish a love alliance between two loved ones. But I have also my conservative side that we all have. And I have to decide. Well, this is one of those Ronnie and Mayan. And I have to decide if I will be able to officiate this ceremony, and if I am willing to be among the pioneer who do so with all that implied. And it is something that implies. So yes, I certainly did this wedding with great joy and excitement. And then anyone who witnesses this special covenant of love felt that God was present and blessed them from heaven. And bless us also, Rabbi, for our religious courage and integrity to push this world slowly but surely for a better future. So I want to finish with a few words about love, because I think this is the basic assumption of Judaism, to celebrate love. And our role, my role, is only to push a little bit two people who have this very lucky mazal to found each other already and help them, those two lovers, to start a new Jewish home based on mutual values, mutual agreement, and full egalitarian principle. Because really it's something that will go on from this moment and will be so significant in their future family, building their family. I hope that the way that we choose in our movement to do so does bring a blessing to the world, a blessing to our community, and especially a blessing to every couple we get to accompany to the chuppah.
Thank you. So, you know, we looked at this legally, we looked at it practically, we looked at it spiritually. So I'm sure there are a number of questions if people want to start putting some questions into the chat bar. I'm going to ask a question to Ari. Can you discuss how a secular Israeli might respond to having a Masorti wedding? You know, do you find that it keeps them more involved with Jewish life in a way that many of us might live our lives that they wouldn't have experienced before, where there's in Israel, it's often chiloni or dati, but here we can bridge the gap?
Thank you, Rachel. It's a good question. I think that the first thing that I would say for that is that every couple that you meet, you remember that the experience of preparing for the wedding is an important Jewish moment, and that is the end and not a mean. And I think that is really important, that we don't, as a rabbi, I can't see every single person that I meet as, is this person going to come to my shul? The short answer for that is going to be most Israelis, if they are secular, aren't looking for shul, they're looking for other Jewish experiences. So if they have that Masorti wedding, I think the most important thing in any situation is that if they have a positive Jewish experience in that moment, if at the time that they're preparing for and getting married, Torah and our tradition are informing how they make their choices, if when they're standing at the chuppah, the 12 minutes or 15 minutes of that ceremony are important to them, and not only just to sort of mark off before they go on to the dancing and the dinner, I think that really leaves a mark. And I would notice that in my rabbinic work outside of doing weddings, when I meet people, I meet a lot of couples, especially when I'm preparing their children for bar and bat mitzvah, and the number of times that they can even say to me, we got married in this kind of way and our rabbi didn't care about us at all, and we're not interested in Judaism, and now we're looking for a different way. Or they could say, well, you know, we're not really religious, but we had a conservative rabbi do our wedding, and that really left a good taste in our mouth, right? It was important for us for our son to have his bar mitzvah here, even though it's a family of all boys and we know he could go to any synagogue. We really liked the way that the Masorti movement handled our getting married, and we want to come back here now for the bar mitzvah. I'll see people who come at Yom Kippur, you know, our one day a year regulars. And for them, you know, they had this positive Jewish experience, and so they want to come back again for more. And then you'll also have, and they're not tons, but you'll have those moments where somebody says, I really like this experience. It really spoke to me. I'm going to look for the Masorti community nearby and be a part of it. I'm going to look for that Kabbalat Shabbat, and I'm going to go, you know, not every single week, but I want this to be a part of my life. And I think that every time we touch people's lives in an appropriate way, in an effective way, give them meaning through Judaism, that's another moment that they say Judaism can be different than what's sold to us on the establishment level, and I want to find it in ways that can make my life meaningful.
I saw a few questions. If you want me, Rabbi Ann, to try to answer,
or please
choose.
Go ahead.
Okay, so we have two questions about both sides of the line, the Reform and the Orthodox, which influence us, or have we, as some, we cooperate with them. So yes, there's more than one time that couple who wanted me to lead them or officiate the wedding, we have some halachic issues that for my Reform colleague are not a problem. We have kind of mutual work with couples. So if they want a day that we are not officiate according to the rabbinical assembly decision and the Reform movement allows, so we just pass from the one couple to other, and vice versa. So we have also from the Reform to the conservative kind of changing. But interesting, Heidi, hi Heidi, you ask if we influence also the Orthodox Israeli. So I just yesterday told that, of course, we challenging them, the modern Orthodox side, not the ultra-Orthodox side. But when we have today also modern Orthodox organization who officiate not via the Rabbanut, out of the Rabbanut, they call to do a real change and deep change in how we celebrate life, Jewish life in Israel. One of the rabbi who was reported, the Haredi one, an ultra-Orthodox one who died from Corona 1 month ago, Rav Eliyahu Bakshi Doron, Zichro Livracha, he was very in favor of to change all the system and to allow all the stream to be able to marry. So we have today non-official and illegal organization, also modern Orthodox. They look at us and say, why them and not us? And that's also kind of a result that our work have.
And if I may also jump in for sure. Just a second to Heidi's question, and then I think also Nancy's question about this. One of the positive ways that we do this, I think, is that a lot of times, sometimes Orthodox friends and family will go to a secular couple's wedding and expect there to be no Judaism. Because that, especially if they know in advance that it is outside of the rabbinate. And when they go and they see a ceremony that deeply speaks to who the couple is, but is really a part of our tradition, even if there are different things. I remember a wedding that I officiated last October, and the bride gave a ring to the groom, and there were, you know, the ketubah was in Hebrew when it was egalitarian. And at the end of the ceremony, this guy with a very, very thick beard and a kippah that made him look like he was definitely a settler from a very far right religious settlement, he walks up to me and I'm like, oh my God, do I really need to speak to this guy? And he just says, that was a beautiful wedding, kol hakavod. And I know that he wouldn't want that for his children. I don't know that. I know that the stereotype in my head wouldn't want that for his children. But I think that when people see how deeply committed we are to Judaism, that they really are impressed that we are able to speak to secular families. And in terms of do we participate, of course, hiding behind the scenes right now is Tommy Gottlieb, who really works tirelessly to help us out. And there really is wonderful coordination between people who believe in religious freedom, secular, conservative reform, and Orthodox, as Rabbi Natalie was talking about. And it's one of these moments of light and aspects of light in our lives, the fact that we really all do believe that we can each do it our own way and that we each deserve to be recognized here.
So I want to thank all of my colleagues and my new friends who came on this call to help present. I want to thank
all of you for taking the time to be on this. Like I said at the beginning, just because there's a pandemic doesn't mean we should ignore some of the systemic issues that are going on in the world. You know, we often say, how are we going to make change? Well, first of all, we need to know who our community is. And we each have our micro communities. I'm certainly very concerned about what's going on at Sutton Place Synagogue and making sure that we not only survive, but thrive, not only in this year, but in the year ahead. And so many of my colleagues on this call are going to feel that about their communities. But we also have an obligation to appreciate what's going on all over the world with the Masorti movement and to feel connected. Because what I keep saying to my community, some of you are on, is if we want the community to be here in 2021, then we need to support it in 2020. And that's the same thing with the Masorti movement. We need to look out beyond the horizon and know that issues of marriage and issues of burial and issues of B'nai Mitzvah and issues of egalitarian practice is something that's not going away. And we do need to talk about this with our communities, but in a way that people can hear it. And I think that that's what's so important and so nuanced about the messaging. As an American, there are plenty of things that drive me crazy about my country these days, more than ever. But I'm not going to give up on being an American and what that stands for. As a Jew and as a Zionist, there are plenty of things that can make me crazy about giving up on Israel, but I'm not going to give up on Israel. And as we share what is challenging, we also need to share the love. And Natalie talked about the love. And we can talk about that which is difficult without giving up on the essential values. And that's what we're doing today. So when we share these challenges, it's not about airing dirty laundry. It's not about saying that we don't want to stay connected to Israel. It's actually about engaging even more. And so please be our partners and please be our ambassadors to think about what this means and how we can continue to strengthen our shared mission. And I hope in the coming months and years, we don't only need to be on Zoom, but that I know that when I bring my shul to Israel, we'll be able to do so much together. So I hope everybody has a great day or night, depending where you are. Stay safe and stay home.